All right, here we go. Let's first talk about example 168. This is the one we skipped last time, and we're going to do it today. So I want you to evaluate, integrate 1 over square root t square minus 6t plus 13 dt. So the trick for this question, this is similar to what you have in homework. So you can see that on the denominator, you have t square minus 6t plus 13. So if you use your algebra skills, so you can see that you can complete the square of this thing. And well, you consider t square minus 6t plus 13. This is going to be t square minus 6t. In order to complete the square, so you need number 9 here, right? Because you need number 9 here, because if you have number 9 here, on the next step, you can complete it to be t minus 3 square, right? But because you have 9 here and you have 13 here, that means you need 4 more to just, you know, keep the equality. So you need split 13. You need to split 13 into 9 and 4 over there. And then after that, you can say, hey, inside the parenthesis, this is t minus 3 square. Well, this is what you learned from, you know, your high school or something, because this is called completing the square. So you should be able to do this one. Everyone, if you don't know how to do this, well, please keep in mind, this will be on the final exam. So you need your complete the square skill, because at least one question on the exam gonna ask you to complete the square and do the integration. So this is the required technique that you need to do it. This is 3 minus 3 square, and then plus, well, 4, you can say this is 2 square. And then once you simplify this thing, you can see that your integral gonna turn to the form 1 over square root t minus 3 square plus 2 square dt. And once you have this form, you can say, hey, it matched with the one we know. So last time I told you that for doing trigonometric substitution, we have x equal to a times sine theta. Okay, 1 second. I'm gonna start from the beginning. Well, if you see a square minus x square, so you can do a substitution x equal to a times sine theta. Well, if you see a square plus x square, well, this is going to be x equal to a times tan theta. Well, if you see x square minus a square, this is going to be x equal to a times secant theta, right? This is what we learned last time. So this x can be, this x can be a function of x as well. Well, for this question, we see t minus 3 and number 2 here. So what are we going to do is we are going to use trigonometric substitution met with the second form. It must be tangent here because I saw the positive sign here. So it is like x squared plus a squared now. So we're going to do x equal to a times tan theta. Sounds good. This is the second form, not the third form of trigonometric substitution. So we're gonna let t minus 3 equal to 2 times tan theta. Well, it matched with that form. So I'm gonna highlight t minus 3 in the yellow one. I'm gonna highlight the number 2 here as the orange one. So you can see it matched with the pattern. And then now we can do the integration. So square plus 2 square dt, right? So first of all, I am going to adjust something inside the integrand first. So t minus 3, this is going to be 2 times tan theta square, right? And then plus 2 square. All right. And you also need to switch dt to d theta. So that means you have to differentiate t with respect to theta. So from here, you're gonna get t equal to 3 plus 2 times tan theta. That means you have dt equal to 2 times secant square theta d theta, right? This is what you have by you just using the differentiation. And then your dt is going to be 2 times secant square theta d theta. This is what you have. Well, you need to simplify a little bit first. So here you're going to get 1 over. So on the denominator here, you can pull out number 4, right? Because now you have square root 4 tangent square plus 1. So I did a little bit fast because I pull out number 4 here and number 4 here. Group it together so you get 4 here. And then inside this, you have 10 square plus 1. Then here on the top, you have 2 times secant square theta d theta. Now you can use the trigonometric identity. So 10 square plus 1 here gonna be secant square. So this is going to be integrate 2 times sec square theta over, well, square root 4 is 2, right? And then that secant, this is secant square, right? And then you take square root, so it's going to be absolute sec. Well, how do we know that absolute here is going to be positive or negative? So, well, to avoid the ambiguous term here, so we're going to define my theta to be something inside negative pi over 2 to pi over 2. Well, if I define something like that, so here it's going to be positive. Well, because I define my secant theta to be on quadrant number 4 or quadrant number 1, right? So it's going to be positive. Well, if you don't have that, I mean, if you do have an definite integrals, so you're going to have your lower bound and upper bound, and your lower bound and upper bound going to force you that you have to use positive or negative side here. All right. Next, well, so this is going to be positive and then it's canceled out. So we're going to have now integrate sec theta d theta, which is good. So we integrate this thing and then we get integrate sec theta d theta. All right. Next, well, we have integrate sec theta d theta, which we have the formula, which is going to be, well, integrate sec, you get log sec theta plus tan theta, right, plus c. And then now, because you have the right triangle here, so first, when you first do a substitution, you say this is t minus 3 equal to 2 times tan theta. That means you have tan theta equal to t minus 3 over 2. Well, if you let this to be theta, this is t minus 3, this is 2, right? And then your hypotenuse here is going to be t minus 3 square plus 4, right? By Pythagorean theorem. And then now you can plug in back. So here you're going to get log absolute. So secant theta here going to be the term here. Secant, it's going to be hypotenuse over the adjacent, which is number 2. And then plus tangent, which is going to be t minus 3 over 2. All right, and then plus c. All right, this is going to be your final answer for this question. On the homework, I think there is one question on the homework 1.6, right, that you need to use this technique. So keep in mind that when you see this form, the denominator, you have something that you can complete square. Well, it's going to go to trigonometric substitution. And this is the popular technique. And we usually ask you to do it on the exam. All right. I'm going to look at the chat. Can we divide the log by 2 and add the negative log 2 to the C? Well, you can stop here to be safe, but if you wanna simplify more, it's up to you. But make sure if you simplify, you did it right, because sometimes you simplify and you get the incorrect one and you lose your point. So I would suggest that to be safe, just stop here. No need to go further than this. But to answer Pima Pon's question, because he wanted to simplify, can we divide the log by 2? I don't get it. And add negative log 2 into C. Well, we can chat after class, but well, I think it is better to stop here, because well, it is easy to mess up when you simplify it. So just keep it clean, or just keep it simple as much as possible. All right, so everyone is here now. I think we have 30 students now. So what we just did on the first 10 minutes, we just doing a review of trigonometric substitution. And this is the end of this chapter, because we already did example 169. So this is chapter 6, integration technique. All right, we're gonna move to chapter 7, which is applications of integration. This is going to be the chapter that we talk about how integration apply to the real world problems. Well, let's look at overview first. Now, if you don't have the lecture note, you can go to Blackboard and download it. The file is a little bit bigger compared to other chapters, so take some time and download it. So I'm gonna talk about the overview first. This is what we're going to learn. So we are going to learn how to use integration to find the regions, I mean the area between two curves. So the second topic, we're gonna learn how to find the volume by slicing. Well, you can see the picture here that, well, if you have any volume, I mean any solid, and then you wanna find the volume of the solid, and you know that the cross section that you cut perpendicular to the axis, it gives you the same shape no matter where you cut the axis. So this is going to be the volume by slicing. We're gonna call this thing, we're gonna look at this thing together in section 7.2. And after that, we're gonna talk about volume of the solid of revolution, which is going to be the popular method that people use to find the volume. We have this method, Washer method, cylindrical shell method. That's the basic one that we're gonna learn this class. And then we're gonna wrap up the chapter by 7.4 here. Today, my plan is we are going to complete section 7.1, regions between curve. At least we should do 7.1. And we're gonna continue 7.2, 3, and 4 next week. And that should be all for chapter 7. Does it make sense? Yesterday, we have a meeting on the final exam. And I think that because you have, you know, a small window to study for chapter 7 and 8. So for sure, we're gonna focus on chapter 5 and 6 on the final exam. So even the content is so hard for chapter 7, but the portion that we're gonna have on the exam is small. So let me write for you again one more time. So for those of you who want to prepare for the final exam, so I would say that you have chapter 5. I think we increase it to 45% now. Well, this is going to be a big chapter, because this is portion for the final, because we already did chapter 5 for a while. So you have time to digest the material now. So I think it is better to test you a lot on chapter 5. So chapter 5 now is 45%. Chapter 6 is about 30% of the exam. This is integration technique. And chapter 7, this is going to be just 20%. What we just learned this thing today and next week. And chapter 8, this is about 5 to 6%, I think, because we're going to learn it one day. Only one question. That's all. 45, 50. Yeah, this is 100%. So keep in mind that when you study for the final exam, you should focus on chapter 5 and 6, because this is what we'll learn. We already passed those two chapters and you have time to study it. So this is our focus. But for sure, chapter 7 and 8, you cannot throw away, but this is only 25% in total. Does it make sense? Any questions? All right, good. Okay, now let's talk about chapter 7. First of all, we're gonna look at the region between curve and how to find the area. You can see that the picture that I show you here on the right-hand side here, this is the example of what are we going to learn this chapter. So for example, you have two curves like this one and the black one. When I want you to find the region between curve, how would you do it? All right, so, well, first of all, before going forward, I want to make sure that you know how to graph the function, because for this chapter, if you do not know how to graph the function, it's over. It's over. So the common question that students usually ask is, can we do this chapter without graphing the function? The answer is no. You should. I mean, well, you have to. I always say that you have to graph the function. So we're going to review the some basic function that you need to know how to graph it. The first one is the linear function y equal to ax plus b. In order to graph this one, so you just need to find the intercepts. When you find x-intercept and y-intercept, you plot it and then you can graph it. For example, if you ask me to graph, let's say y equal to 2x minus 1. How do I graph it? Very quick. So I'm gonna say, hey, I'm gonna pick x equal to 0 and then that's y equal to negative 1, right? So that means the graph gonna pass the point x equal to 0, y equal to negative 1, which is this point. And then I'm gonna let y equal to 0 and then I solve for x, x equal to 1/2. So that means the graph pass this point 1/2 and y equal to 0. So that means you can draw the line here. It's gonna, well, I don't have a ruler here, but this is a line y equal to 2x minus 1, right? You should be able to graph the linear function quick and easy, because it's gonna be your basic for this chapter. And also the parabola one. So for parabola one, keep in mind that you have the equation ax squared plus bx plus c. And when you graph it, it's gonna be the open up parabola or the open down parabola, depends on the value of a. If your a less than 0, well, it's gonna be the open down parabola. If your a is positive, it's gonna be open up parabola, right? And well, the vertex here, if you wanna find it, you can plug in x equal to minus b over 2a, right? This is going to be the point that gives you the vertex of the parabola. So if you cannot remember this one, well, you already learned that it's gonna, the parabola is maximized when f prime x equals to 0. So you can differentiate the quadratic function and solve for x. Well, that is how you graph it. All right. But the basic one is y equal to x squared, something like that. So you should be able to graph it. This is the open up one. All right, next we have, well, for sure, if we ask you for some cubic function, a square root function or exponential function or log logarithm function, you should be able to graph it. The basic one is y equal to x cubed. This is the x cubed one. So the red one here is x cubed. For square root one, this is going to be the, just like that, square root, right? The domain of square root is just 0 to positive infinity. So it's like that. So for the exponential one, something like y equal to e to the x. So the gap is something like that. Well, you will see that when we do more and more and more problems, for each problem, we're gonna graph the function first. You're gonna learn, you're gonna review the graphing technique by the time. All right, so let's start by looking at how to graph these three functions on example 176. So the first one is y equal to square root x minus 2. Well, you know what, on the exam, the basic question is we're gonna ask you to graph first. Well, if you don't know how to graph, it's over. It's over. You just get zero on that part for sure if you don't know how to graph. So the first one you're gonna here. I mean, if you don't know how to graph it, let's look at this. So you have y equal to square root x minus 2. The base one is going to be y equal to square root x. This is the base one. Well, y equal to square root x is here, right? But because you just switch it to x minus 2, this means you just transform it. So y equal to square root x minus 2 mean you move to the right 2 units, right? So that mean from here, you're gonna just walk to the right 2 units. This is going to be the graph y equal to square root x minus 2. Right? When you replace x by x minus a, that means you're gonna move to the right hand side 2 units. So you can make sure when you transform it, you can double check yourself. Hey, the graph passed the point 2, 0. Yeah, that's right. Right, that's right. So this is the one, this is the graph. And then for example, the next one, if you have y equal to x cubed plus 1. So the base one is y equal to x cubed. And then you see, you can see that you add 1 here. That means you shift everything up 1 unit. So when you plot the graph, so the base of the graph gonna be x cubed, which is the red one here. This is x cubed. And then you just move everything up 1 unit. So it's gonna be y equal to x cubed plus 1. And this is x equal to 0, y equal to 1. Well, this is the basic technique. The last one is, let's see, let's say you have y equal to square root, absolute x plus 2 minus 1. So this is going to be y equal to absolute x. This is your base, right? Gonna be absolute value function, which is the V-shaped graph. And then, well, what you did is just you move to the left 2 units, right? Because you have x plus 2 here, and then you're going down 1 unit. So this is going to be, you move to the left 2 units, and then you're going down 1 unit. Your vertex gonna be at negative 2, negative 1. So, I mean, don't worry about my scale. I don't know my scale is right or wrong because I'm lazy to just make a proper scale, but that is the absolute value when y equal to absolute x plus 2 minus 1. If the graph is too hard to plot by hand, we're gonna give it for you. But usually the one that we ask, it's going to be the one that it is easy to graph. So let's start by looking at the theory and then we're gonna do some more problems. All right, so, well, we just did the review on graphing the functions. So let's start section 7.1, regions between curve. So we have the formula for the area here. So when you have the function fx and gx, so you can find a region that is bounded between them by using the formula in the box. So the idea is, so I'm gonna talk about the idea first. So the idea is you have fx, the green, the blue one, and gx, the yellow one. So if you wanna find the area, you can use the Riemann sum idea. So you're gonna chop up your x interval into n pieces. For example, if I say I'm gonna have from x equal to a to x equal to b, right? So I'm gonna chop up my area here, my region here into n pieces. And for each piece, I'm gonna draw the box to approximate the area, right? So after I do that, well, I'm gonna compute the area of the box here. And then I add the area up. So at the end, if I chop the interval into infinity pieces. So it's going to be the area. That is the idea. So you can see that when you speak this thing in terms of math. So when you say that you draw a box here, well, the box going to have the width delta x, the one that you just call it delta x. This is going to be just the length, the width of the box. And the height of the box here, this is going to be, I mean, the box that you have going to hit the top with the blue line, going to hit the bottom with the yellow line. So that means your height of the box going to be, let me use the green one. So it's going to be F minus G. Well, and the area of the box is going to be delta X times F minus G. Right, and then when you sum, when you multiply it together, you get the area for just one box, and then you sum it. That means you compute the area of every block, and then after that you change the summation to integrate, because you take limit when n go to infinity. That means you chop this thing infinitely many times. You just make it more and more and more and more. At the end, it's going to be continuous and limit of summation. This is integration. Well, that is when you find the area, you can just integrate from a to b. Fx minus gx was, I mean, what you have to be careful is your f here must be your upper curve, your gx here must be your lower curve. Well, the f1 must be on the top one, the gx1 must be on the bottom one. That is what you have to be careful, because we have the condition that fx greater than or equal to gx. Well, let's look at some examples. This is the easy one, man. Well, this is the finding the area is easy one. The hard one is finding the volume. The area is just the top one minus the bottom one, and then you integrate from A to B. That's all. All right, so this is the steps for finding the area. So first of all, you need to sketch the graph. If it is not given, well, for sure on the exam, it is not given. So you need to graph it. And then you need to find the intersection points if need. And then you need to, well, draw the vertical line. I mean, you just chop it up into n pieces, right? Well, that means draw a vertical line. I don't know why I type this thing. And then evaluate a equal to that by using the formula. Well, keep in mind f is the top function and g is the bottom function. All right, so let's look at the first one. So let's graph f and g first. And then after you graph f and g, we're gonna find the area. Sounds good, everyone? All right. So for f, we have 4x minus x squared. Right, I'm gonna do it. Fx equal to 4x minus x squared. So how do I graph it? Well, for sure, this is the open down parabola, right? Because you have minus here. Let's graph it. This is y. This is x. You can see that this is the open down parabola. So what is the vertex here? If I differentiate one time, so I get 4 minus 2x. That means f prime x equal to 0 when x equal to 2. So the vertex is at x equal to 2. When x equal to 2, that means y equal to 4, right? Because we're going to have 8 minus 4, which is 4. So the vertex here is going to be when x equal to 2 and y equal to 4. This is 2 and 4, right? And then after that, you can see that, hey, this is going to be the parabola open down. Well, it looks like it's going to cut this thing at 0, 0. Well, I want to make sure that it's cut x interval, I mean, x axis at 0, 0. So that's mean, well, let's try to plug in when x equal to 0. So I get y equal to 0 as well, right? Because if I plug in 0, it gets 0, 0. So for sure, this is cut at 0, 0. And if I plug in 4, so I get 0 as well. If I plug in x equal to 4, so I get 0. Y equal to 0 as well. So this is actually the graph of y equal to 4x minus x squared, right? It takes some time to graph it. And then next, we have gx equal to x. This is the easy one. This is y equal to x, gx equal to x, right? And then after that, you want to, 1 second, I look at the chat. Okay, no question on the chat, good. All right, after that, you need to find a region bounded by these two graphs, which is going to be the one that I highlight in yellow, right? It's pretty clear that it's gonna be this one. So you can see that you're gonna integrate it here to find the area. All right, so your area gonna be integrated from the top function minus the bottom function and then dx. So the top function is the red one here. The red one is y equal to 4x minus x squared. So this is going to be the red one. This is the top function. Well, this is your first example, so I go pretty slow. But on the exam, you don't have to say a top function, bottom function. Well, I mean, if you are familiar with it, you can just go ahead and do it. Well, the bottom one, this is the green one, right? You can see that the top one that's covered the area is going to be the red. The bottom one is going to be the green one. So this is the x, just x, right? This is the bottom function. All right, and then what is going to be your lower bound and upper bound for integration? So you start from x equal to 0. And then to this point, right? You can imagine that you're trying to draw the vertical line from x equal to 0 and keep going, keep going, keep going. And then it's gonna end when x equal to at this point. So you want to know what is x at this point. So it's gonna be 0 to somewhere here. So you need to find the intersection between these two points. So how do you find the intersection? So the intersection gonna be, well, for sure, it's gonna be the point that F and G intersect, which means the point that 4x minus x squared equal to x, right? Because this is the point that F and G cut. So this is going to be 4. Well, I minus 1x, so 3x minus x squared equal to 0, which means x equal to 0 or 3, which means the point that they cut is when x equal to 3, y equal to 3, right? So 0 to 3, you integrate the area. Does it make sense? And then you just integrate this thing. So the rest of the work, this is just integration. So I have 3x minus x squared dx, and then I integrate that. So I got 3x squared over 2 minus x cubed over 3. Evaluate at x equal to 3, x equal to 0, and then this is 9 over 2. Well, I already did this number at home, so well, just 9 over 2. All right, any questions on this example? Well, this is your first example about finding the area, and hopefully you see that this is not that hard. So, well, first of all, graph the function, and then sometime you need to find the intersection point, and then you need to set up the integral for the area. That's it for this chapter. I mean, for this topic. Good. All right, we're gonna move. Well, if you have any question, just stop me on the chat so we can slow down the process. So next one is example 178. So let's do the trigonometric functions. All right, let's suppose that we have y equal to psi x, y equal to cosine x, and the x-axis. We wanna compute the area when x is between 0 to pi over 2. All right. Simple. So we're gonna just draw the x-axis and y-axis here. And then what are we going to do is, well, let's keep y equal to psi x to be the green one. All right, so I'm going to draw y equal to psi x. Well, y equal to psi x is going to pass 0, 0, right? And it's going to have a peak. Well, it's going to have a peak at x equal to pi over 2, right? And then y equal to 1, right? And then and keep going. So it's going to come back to pi and 0. This is y equal to psi x. And keep going this way, keep going this way, whatever, but who cares? Next one is we're going to dot y equal to cosine x. Well, I'm going to choose another color so you can see it clearly. So let's do the orange one to be cosine x. So the cosine x is going to pass x equal to 1, y equal to 0, right? And then at pi over 2, it's going to be pi over, it's going to be x equal to pi over 2. Oops. This is going to be 0, right? And then keep going. All right, so what is the region they want? So you can see that the question asks you to find the region bounded by the graph of y equal to psi x, y equal to cosine x, and the x-axis, where x is between 0 to pi over 2. So the area is just this one that I am going to highlight in light blue. Would you agree? This is x from 0 to pi over 2. And it is bounded by y equal to psi x, y equal to cosine x, and x axis. It's going to be just this part. Does it make sense? It's going to be just this part. And then now you want to find the area of this thing. So you need to chop this thing to n pieces and then you integrate. Well, first of all, to make the world easy, so you can think of your intersection here first, because this is going to be your intersection point between y equal to psi and y equal to cosine. So what is going to be your intersection point here? So for those of you who are familiar with trigonometric function, well, this is pi over 4 and square root 2 over 2, right? Because psi x equal to cosine x when x equal to pi over 4, right? For those of you who don't know how to solve it, maybe it's psi x over cosine x equal to 1, and then tan 45 equal to 1, tan x equal to 1. That means your x must be pi over 4. So your intersection is going to be at pi over 4. Make sense? Well, now when you find the area, so you can see that when you find the area, so you need to integrate the top function minus the bottom function. So the first part, you're gonna have the top one to be the green function, right? This part that I just trying to make it thick, this is the green one. This is the top part when x from 0 to pi over 4. So I'm gonna say when x from 0 to pi over 4, my top function is psi x. My bottom function is the x-axis, which is y equal to 0. So it's going to be psi x minus 0 dx, and then plus integrate from pi over 4 to pi over 2, right? From pi over 4 to pi over 2, my top function is going to be the orange one here. This is going to be cosine x. So that means I need to use cosine x here. And then minus the bottom function, which is 0, dx. All right. Does it make sense? Well, hopefully you find that this is easy. I mean, I know some of you already did this one in high school, but we're going to just make it clean and, you know, proper for this class. Next, we are going to integrate this thing. Sure, yeah. So integrate psi x dx, I get cosine, negative cosine, sorry. From pi over 4, 0 to pi over 4, plus integrate cosine, I get psi from pi over 4 to pi over 2. All right, the answer is going to be negative cosine pi over 4 plus cosine 0, and then plus psi over 2. Psi pi over 2 minus psi pi over 4. All right, you just need to compute that. So negative square root 2 over 2 plus 1 plus 1 minus square root 2 over 2. All right, the answer is going to be 2 minus square root 2. Square units. Make sense? All right. Any questions so far? Pretty easy, isn't it? All right. All right. Any questions? Anything else? No, right? Okay, good. Sounds good. Next, we are going to look at the area between two curves again. But this time, we are going to look at some region that is easy to integrate when you integrate with respect to y. So let's look at the idea. So we say that some region, when you draw the picture, it is good to integrate with respect to y. So for example, if you look at the picture here, so you can see that if I try to integrate with respect to x, that means I try to draw the vertical line. So what happened is here, 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 here. So I'm trying to chop the function into n pieces with respect to x. So the hardest part is you can see that at some point, I start from the pink curve, and then I go up to the constant y equal to something. And at some point, I start from the constant y equal to something to the black one. So if you do the integrate with respect to x, for this picture, it's going to be super hard because you have to split into multiple x intervals, right? Because on some interval, you start from one curve to one curve. On another interval, you start from one curve to one curve. This is ridiculous that you're going to do integrate with respect to x. So we're going to switch the axis. So we're going to just look at integrate with respect to y. So in order to do integrate with respect to y, we're going to draw the horizontal line. And that is much better because now you can integrate from the, you can see that you integrate from the pink one here to the black one there all the time, right? No matter y value is, you're going to start from the pink curve here to the black curve over there. So the idea of the area of the region between two curves with respect to y, you're going to use the same formula as with respect to x. However, you're going to do f minus g here. You have to make sure that f is a function on the right. Gy is the function on the left, right? Fy must be bigger than or equal to gy. So the function on the right-hand side must be your f. The function on the left-hand side must be your g. And in order to keep us informed that you are doing integration with respect to y, we're going to use dy here. And your c and d are going to be just, you know, the upper bound and lower bound on the picture. So for here, this is y equal to c. This is y equal to d. All right, let's do it. Let's do a real example. All right, example 179, I want you to find the area bounded by the graph y equal to x minus 2 and x equal to y squared. All right, first of all, we need to graph it. Let's do it. Y and x. So we're gonna draw x equal to y squared first. What is the shape here? Parabola, right? Well, y equal to x squared is just the open up parabola. If you switch x and y, it's gonna be parabola, but it's open on this one. This is x equal to y squared. Can you see that if you cannot graph it, it's over. And then after that, y equal to x minus 2, this is going to be, all right, this is the This is the line, right? So I'm gonna find the intersection. I'll find the intercept first. Okay, when x equal to 0, y equal to negative 2. When x equal to 0, y equal to negative 2. Let's say it's here. And then when x equal to 2, y equal to 0. All right, so that. Well, so I know that the region that I want is here. This is the region that bounded by two intervals, I mean two curves. And then now I can, well, in order to integrate, well, we need the intersection anyway, right? So we're gonna find the intersection now. So intersection first. So how do you find the intersection? So we let this two equation equal to each other. Well, we have y equal to x minus 2 and x equal to y square, right? So that's mean x equal to y plus 2 and x equal to y square. Well, that's mean y plus 2 equal to y square. And that is y square minus y minus 2 equal to 0. So y minus 2 times y plus 1 equal to 0, that means y equal to 2 and negative 1. So our intersection gonna happen at y equal to 2 and x and y equal to negative 1. So when y equal to 2, that means x equal to, well, y equal to 2 here. X must be 4, right? And then when y equal to 1, y equal to negative 1, x equal to 1. You can look at the picture, right? That it matched with the picture. So we have two intersection, which is 4, 2 and negative 1 to 1. Well, I'm gonna delete the intercept here because we are not going to use it anyway. All right, now let's see. Well, are you going to integrate with respect to x or integrate with respect to y? You can see which one is easier. You should use that one. So for this question, you can see that if you plan to integrate with respect to x, you have to draw the vertical line here. Terrible. Because from 0 to 1, you're going to integrate from parabola to parabola. And then from 1 to 4, you're going to integrate from the line to parabola. Which means if you choose to integrate with respect to x, well, if you should integrate with respect to x, what you have to do is a equal to integrate from 0 to 1, one integral, and then add from 1 to 4, another integral. So from 0 to 1, you're gonna start from y equal to square. You're gonna start from the, well, this is the red one, right? This is the red one. So you're gonna start by the red one on the top minus the red one on the top. So, and this is the red one on the top minus the green one, the bottom, dx, right? Which is, here's the green one. Does it make sense? Well, is this a good one? I would say this is a terrible choice. Because you need to split the integration. You can see the easier one is you integrate with respect to y. Because if you integrate with respect to y, so you don't have to split the region. Because every time when you draw the horizontal line, you're gonna start from the red one to the green one, the red one to the green one, the red one to the green one all the time, right? So you integrate with respect to y, you're gonna have the green one on the right hand side. And then you're gonna minus the red one on the left-hand side, and that is dy. So y gonna start from negative 1 to 2, right? Because this is y from negative 1 to 2. And then when you integrate that, so you get integrate negative 1 to 2, the green one is going to be what? So here, sorry, that is dy. So when you integrate with respect to y, you're gonna put x equal to function of y into that function. So the green one is going to be, the green one is y equal to x minus 2, right? This is the same thing with x equal to y plus 2. So that means you have y plus 2 here. So keep in mind that when you integrate with respect to y, the thing inside the integrand must be a function of y. So I'm going to put something in terms of y there. For x here, I'm going to put y squared here. And then now you can integrate. Well, I'm going to keep doing it. So it's going to be 2y, right? Oh no, y squared over 2 plus 2y, and then minus y cubed over 3. All right, and then I evaluate at y equal to 2 minus y equal to negative 1. I already did this one. This is 9 over 2. Well, you can do it at home. It just, you know, plug in numbers. Well, this is integrate with respect to y. A lot easier compared to integrate with respect to x. For those of you who are curious, what if I choose to integrate with respect to x? Yes, it is not wrong, but it just, you know, this is the detour. So if you do integrate with respect to x, so what happened? So you're gonna set up the integral to be integrate 0 to 1. So the red one minus the red one mean, because your x equal to y squared, you can split it into two equations, y equal to square root x and y equal to minus square root x. So the top one here gonna be just y equal to square root x. The bottom one here gonna be y equal to minus square root x. So here you're gonna get square root x minus square root x dx, right? And then plus integrate 1 to 4. The top one is square root x. The green one is x minus 2, right? Because this is the function of the green one. Well, if you integrate this thing, you get 9 over 2 as well. Is this a terrible choice? Because you have to do more work, in my opinion, because you split the integral, but well, at the end, you get the same answer anyway. Does it make sense? So on the exam, when you see the problem, well, we will not tell you if you should do integrate with respect to x or integrate with respect to y. It's going to be your choice. And if you are smart, you're going to save your time. If you feel like, hey, I'm going to do integrate with respect to x all the time, Ajahn, I don't care integrate with respect to y. Well, it's your choice, but you may, you know, spend more than 10 minutes with integrate with respect to x while your friend just do it quick, integrate with respect to y. Does it make sense? Well, that is the take home point for today. So when you do integrate, you can do two ways, integrate with respect to x or integrate with respect to y. And then, well, some situation, it's gonna be a lot easier to integrate on one variable compared to another variable. All right, let me see. We have, yeah, two examples left on the area. So we should complete that thing today. All right, before we start example 180, so do you have any questions? No? All right, good. So example 180, we want you to express the area of the following regions in terms of A. Well, we have two questions. So let's say that I want you to express the following regions, the area of the following regions in terms of integral with respect to x, that the first question. And the second question is integrate with respect to y. All right, so we're gonna do these two things in one question, but I mentioned here that do not need to evaluate the integrals. Okay, do not need to evaluate integrals. So that means when you set up the problem, just leave it there, you're done. All right, so let's do it together. All right, we have y equal to x cubed, which is that. Let's draw the graph first. Y equal to x cubed, that. Y equal to x cubed. All right, next we have, what else? Y equal to x plus 6. All right, this is the big one. So it's gonna cut this thing at negative 6 and 0. And then gonna cut this thing at 0 and 6. However, well, let's draw it. My scale is not that perfect, but here, yeah, let's say that is the cutting point. And then, well, for sure, it's gonna cut y equal to x cubed at one point. So you can solve for the intersection now because we're gonna use it anyway. So x cubed equal to x plus 6. So what is going to be the intersection here? Well, if you eyeball it, so you can see that it's gonna cut at x equal to 2, right? Because when x equal to 2, well, it match that 2 and 8. This is the intersection, right? Because when you plug in 2, you get 8 equal to 2 plus 6. Well, that's fine. But, well, if you feel like, hey, Ajahn, I don't know how to eyeball it. I just need to do the math. So you just solve the cubic equation. So you can factor out x minus 2. Well, I mean, I can factor cubic, but some of you, I mean, most of you are gonna have a hard time to factor the cubic one. So I would suggest you to do the, just eyeball it, just trying to pick some number, because the number that we give it to you is going to be the nice one. So it should be an integer or something. So if you wanna factor the cubic equation, so you can use the remainder theorem. Well, if, you know, I don't know how you call it, factor theorem or whatever. Well, you can check that 2 is one root and then you factor out. Well, that's it. Here, that's mean, well, you have intersection here, 2 and 8. So one more curve, you have the x-axis, right? Which is going to be that x-axis. All right, for sure. My area is going to be this one. Yay. All right, which one is easier, integrate with respect to x or integrate with respect to y? So you can think at the same time with me here. So which one is easier? Okay, let's type in the chat. Which one is easy? Which one that you do not need to split the integral into two pieces? Dx or dy, which one? Which one is easier, the x or the y? I mean, if you have to do one, you're gonna do the x or the y. All right, well, it seems like majority goes to dy. All right, thank you everyone for participate. So we're gonna just look at the equation and do the x or the y. I mean, some of you are gonna say the x is easier, some of you are gonna say dy is easier. So let's look at how to manipulate this thing together. So let's suppose that I do dx. So let's start from dx first. So integrate with respect to x. If I choose to do integrate with respect to x, I have to draw the vertical line, right? Because this is going to be hey, 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 like that all the time. And then that means the area gonna be integrate. Well, let's go back to the picture. Well, when I start from x equal to negative 6, well, I start from the green one to the purple one all the time. Green to purple, green to purple, green to purple, green to purple, green to purple. However, at some point, I got stuck. Well, that doesn't mean area here gonna be from integrate negative 6 to this point, which is 0, 0. Negative 6 to 0. Well, the top function gonna be y equal to x cubed, right? Minus, oh no, no, not x cubed. The top function gonna be y equal to x plus 6. This is the top function, right? The purple one here. The top function gonna be the purple one here, which is y equal to x plus 6. And then you can think of the bottom one, it's going to be the x equal to 0, y equal to 0, so it's just 0, the x. And then plus, integrate from 0 to 2, right? Well, my scale is not good. I mean, you can see 2 is here, negative 6 is here, but well, if you scale it properly, it's just going to be more realistic. Well, if I do the up here, you can see that this time, if I get 0 to 2, so my top function is going to be x plus 6. However, my bottom function is just x cubed because we have the red curve on the bottom line here. All right. Well, I expect a lot that you can do the area question on the exam, you know. And then here I'm going to get negative 6 to 0 x plus 6 dx plus integrate 0 to 2 negative x cubed plus x plus 6 dx. This is how you do integrate with respect to x. And the question said do not evaluate the integral. So you can leave it here. This is your answer. Done. Well, if the question said do not evaluate, you stop here. Good. Well, if you do dy, so I'm going to go a little bit faster. So if you do dy, so you can see that you're going to draw the vertical line here. And you do not need to split the integral because every time you're going to start from the purple one to the red one, right? So that means if you integrate the area with respect to y, if you use dy, so y going to start from y equal to 0 to y equal to 8, right? Here it's y equal to 0 and to y equal to 8. And then your right-hand side function going to be x equal to cube root of y, right? Because this is y equal to x cubed. That means x equal to cube root of y. And then minus x equal to y minus 6, right? Because you have y equal to x plus 6. So that means x equal to y minus 6. And then that is our area for integrate with respect to y. All right. So it depends on you which one is easier. But well, if you ask me, I'm going to say dy because I do not need to split the integral. All right. We have one more example, the last one for today. But I'm going to look at the chat. It looks like you have so many questions over there, maybe. All right, we have a question from Mr. Pepper. He said, can I use triangle area for interval negative 6? Or can I use the triangle? Yes. I mean, if we ask you to compute the area and you know that this is a triangle, you're going to say, hey, Ajahn, I'm going to integrate only the right-hand side of the y-axis. So on the left-hand side of the y-axis, I know this is an triangle, so I can compute the area by 1/2 time height time base. That's why you can do it. But you know, on the exam, the picture is not going to be easy like that. So it's going to be the curve that you cannot split to the triangle or something. But this is just to show you the idea first. All right, let's do the last one for today together. So maybe 5 to 10 minutes more, and then that's all for today. So we're going to stop at the second part of example 180. And the next class, next Monday, we're gonna start section 7.2, volume by slicing. This is the hard one. The hard one for this chapter is section 7.2, volume by slicing. We're gonna look at how to compute a volume next week. So this week, let's do this one as the last one for today. And hopefully you have the idea how to compute the area. All right. That y, that x. All right, so we're gonna draw y, the line y equal to e to the x. Let's say this is this one. All right, what is going to be the graph of y equal to e to the negative x? Well, it's gonna be the same graph, but you just switch x to negative x. Like that, right? Just switching x from positive to negative. So it's going to be the reflection of y equal to e to the x. And then the last one is x equal to log 3. Just the line here. So the area that is bounded by this region is going to be the one that I highlight in light blue. All right. I have that graph. So I'm going to integrate with respect to x. I'm going to integrate with respect to y. So let's do integrate with respect to x first. Well, I'm going to do that, integrate with respect to x. Right, easy one. So it's going to be area equal to integrate. So the top one, well let's find it. Intersection. So this point going to be 0, 1. This is the one that exponential function pass. This point going to be when x equal to log 3. That means y equal to e to the log 3, which is 3. All right. And then this is x equal to log 3. And y equal to e to the negative log 3, which is 1/3. All right. That means I'm going to integrate from 0 to log 3. Right. This is x value, and then I'm gonna integrate from the red curve to the green curve. So that means e to the x minus e to the minus x dx. That's it. Right. Integrate with respect to x, super easy. And then you can see if you want to integrate with respect to y, what the hell? You have to draw the horizontal line, right? And then that means you need to split the integral into two pieces. So the area, if you want, if you choose to integrate with respect to y, it's going to be integrated from, well, this point, which is log 3, 1/3, to this point first, 0, 1, and then to that point next, log 3 and 3. So the first integral is going to be 1/3 to 1, right? And then on the right-hand side, you have x equal to log 3. On the left-hand side, you have x equal to negative log y, all right? So I'm going to go slower than that. So how do I know that this is negative log y? So y equal to e to the x, negative x. Well, this means log y equal to log e to the negative x, which means log y equal to e to the minus x, sorry. Well, that means x equal to minus log y, all right? That is why I got that. And then dy, all right? That is the first piece here. Well, I need the second piece as well. So it's gonna be integrate from 1 to 3. Now it's gonna be log 3 minus log y, right? Because y equal to e to the x, it's just x equal to log y. All right, and then dy. All right, you can see that this is pretty clear that integrate with respect to x is a lot easier, because if you do integrate with respect to y, you're gonna end up with logarithm, and then you have to use integration by parts. That is not good, because if you wanna compute this thing, you have to do by parts, which is meh. Not, you don't wanna do that. All right, sounds good. All right, so we're gonna stop the lecture, the content for today. So for the remaining 10 to 15 minutes, I'm gonna stay here for questions, I think. Well, if you have any questions, let me know, or you can ask now. If you wanna leave, thank you very much for attending today. All right, thank you all.